In this video, I will explain how time-lapse sequence of images can be quickly analyzed with Fiji, the free software. So let's go. Let's get started. I have Fiji installed here on my computer, and I have a time-lapse sequence of image which is there. So I can read this time-lapse sequence of image here. So these are basically beans that have been monitored from top view. We have all in all 1,216 images. And there is one image every 15 minutes. So at the beginning, nothing happened. This is during inhibition. And at some point, we will see the cotyledons popping out of the soil, and the process of growth going on, like opening of the cotyledons, these movements typical of the beans. It's always fascinating to look at these time lapse, and you see that just by copy pasting your data through Imagy, you can have a look at them very easily in just one click. Yeah. So we can accelerate a bit. If I make on pause here and I shift, I see that okay, there is opening. And then here there is this kind of events that happened in the end, which can happen also on your facility, that someone is not aware that there is an experiment going on and is moving the camera or the plants. So that's the end of the experiment is not accurate anymore. So we're going to see how we can process these images. But first of all, you notice that actually I already started with a TIFF image, which is maybe not the format that you will have in your case. So in your case, maybe you will have more images which are stored individually in a single folder. So how to make this a TIFF in Imagy? So basically, you go to import image sequence, and then you just have to select the first image of the sequence of images. And then the soft will indicate you the number of images. So here I just put a small number of them. It helps, it enables you to select the starting image, the increment. So if you have oversampled your time-lapse, you can take a little bit less of images. You can also scale down if you want to make yourself a quick idea of what's in there. If the amount of data is too large, then you can scale it down. If ever you fear that you will overcome your memory disk, you can use the virtual stack option here, which basically will, if you do this and you have something that is overpassing the limit of your computer processing capability, it will just load the few images which are around the one that you are visualizing at one time. So that even if you are, let's say, 1 terabyte, a sequence of image which is 1 terabyte, the software will be able to load it virtually, because it will only load the amount of images which are around the pointer on the image that you are looking at. So if you move it slowly enough, it will always have enough memory to load the images which are surrounding it. So if I do this here, this is what I get, and the time of loading will be independent almost on of the number of images that you have. May I also recall you that if you are limited in terms of memory on your computer, you have the possibilities to here. So I think it's in file. Sorry, edit. I think it's in options. There is something which is called memory thread and threads. So here you have the possibility to increase the memory that you you decide that your computer will allow to allocate to Fiji, and the number of parallel threads that you allow. So you can decide that you have one computer that you completely use only for Imagi and Fiji, and put the maximum RAM that your computer has. So that it gives all its power to Fiji. So you can change it, and then I think it needs to restart. If you change the value, it needs to restart the software. Okay, so this is how I get actually a TIFF of my experiment here. And so now let's start to process this. So I mentioned that actually I have something here which is a mistake in the end, problem during the experiment. And here I will stop actually analyzing the data. The useful analysis are only from 1 to 1102. So what I can do is just duplicate, for instance, and go from 1 to 2. Duplicate the stack here, and I can close this one. Now, from the beginning to the end, I have only useful information, let's say. A second artifact is that the camera might not be completely aligned with your plants, and that somehow you could have the need of cropping it. So a possibility is to rotate the image, so it goes in image, transform, and then in rotate. But first, I need to measure by which angle I should rotate this stack. So I will take this angular tool. Let's measure like this. So it's okay, this is something like 2 degrees, something like about 2.4 degrees. Okay, so I will go image, transform, rotate by an angle of 2. So maybe I'm wrong about the rotation direction, if it's the good one or not. So this is not a good one. I should go in the negative direction, 2. And this is like this. Okay. I can decide or not to interpolate here my image. Depending on the resolution, it can be interesting to take care of this because it can create artifacts. I will apply this transformation to the entire stack. And now, this is like this. So if I have some background that I want to remove, then I can draw some cropping zone here to reduce it to the maybe useful, only useful part. So now my data set is 329 megabyte, while it was at the beginning 401. So I'm a bit compressed the amount of requested memory. So now if I want to have a kind of a fast view of what's in my stack, what is possible is just to go in stack and then to choose something which is called plot z-axis profile. So this plot z-axis profile enables you to plot directly in just one click, actually, the evolution of the gray levels as a function of the number of slices. So here as a function of time. So you may say that it is not gray level, but it is RGB images. So there is first a RGB to gray conversion, so that it's more or less the average gray level after RGB to gray conversion. So there's a lot of information on such a curve, which can be then exported very easily. If I go to list, I have all the information of the plot which are there, and this can be further saved as an Excel file or whatever you the format, JSON or whatever you are interested in. But already this gives already a lot of information. So may I recall that number of slices are actually to be converted in 15 minutes. So this would be easily done in R or in Python or Excel, whatever software that you are using. So more or less what it says is that the gray level is first decreasing and then it's increasing again. So what does it correspond to? So I'm going the raw long evolution here. So it says that this is increasing because more or less the leaves are much whiter or much lighter, let's say, than the soil, which is much darker. So as the leaves are being deployed, then the average evolution of the gray level will go up. But first, there is a kind of decrease. So what does this decrease corresponds to? It corresponds, so we can go live here, and it will help us to indicate where we are exactly. So the decrease, the maximum of the decrease is somewhere like this. Okay, so there is first an increase. This is the important stuff to be commented. Yeah, actually, why does it increase here? And this can be the sign that actually there is a lack of watering. And this is what we clearly see here. If there is a lack of watering, your soil will go slightly lighter. And you could use such curve to detect, for instance, that there is an issue in the watering of your system. So this is a kind of information which are directly accessible with this with such a plot. Then you may have seen that there is this kind of very dark images which are basically here. So if I'm on this. So periodically there are some dark images, so you might be able to guess that these images are basically just the night event where our system detects that it is the night. And so we have, I will remove the live here. And so we have one dark image during the night. Each time we detect that this is a night, we just record one dark image during the night, just to remember that this was the night event. And so we don't record during the rest of the night, and we just record back when the light is switched on. So more or less you have a kind of a growing curve, or you can monitor the process. So here I can detect around slice 200 that I have an issue of watering, and then I can detect if I am doing a kind of a detection of growth here, that around 600 there start to be a growth process, which is related actually to the presence of the leaves. So you see, only with one click, I have an analysis of 1,000 images. So a full process of two weeks of monitoring of plants, and you could imagine to have this process being analyzed on the online, so on the fly. so that you were you would be capable of having some warnings of issue of the growth analysis. So now let's start to go a little bit more in depth in the analysis of our images. So basically, if you want to do some analysis here, you might notice that there are some of these white stones which are used when you want to grow such seedlings to put a little bit more air in the soil or to control the compactness of the soil. And this could be a little bit limiting for your analysis. So here, this is place where denoising algorithm can be tested. So my advice is instead of when you want to test some such analysis, is not to to process the entire image, which is huge, which is large in terms of memory space, but maybe just to make a crop around one pot, so that you can see the typical result of your denoising. So some typical denoising when you have some kind of spurious noise here could be a filter of median filter, because more or less you have outliers. These white stones appear as outliers, so the denoising will be better with the nonlinear median operator by comparison with the Gaussian blur, which is operating like it is blurring around the error. So if you have an outlier, the error due to the outlier is just not removed, it's just blurred around, while a non-linear median operator will do a better job. So basically here it seems that these outliers have something like 1 or 2 pixels. So if we take something like 3 pixels, we will almost remove all these outliers, but also possibly delay a bit the detection of the cotyledon, which at the beginning will look like like one of these white stones. So here I have something very homogeneous, and I removed almost all the background. You may see also that I'm losing a bit of resolution around the images, so that's the issue with any kind of convolution local algorithm. So there are alternatives to such denoising. Let me indicate some of them. So one of them is called the mean shift. I will take the same radius here, and I noticed the color distance to be used. Here I processed the entire stuff, and it's not maybe as perfect here for this setting, but you can see that in terms of shape and blurriness of the sharpness of the edge is much better. So that's mean shift. That's a denoising method, which is a standard, well-known method in image processing. And another alternative is called non-local mean, which is also available in Fiji. So non-local denoising. Here again, this is something where I fixed the parameter before, in this case to optimize them. And in this case, it's a little bit longer. This method is more greedy in terms of the image processing, because more or less it is looking for the same pattern to occur in the image. In a small imaget of chosen of 15 pixels here. And you will see that here again, the edges are much more preserved than it was in the median. So you can pick up the one you want if you want to avoid having spurious noise, especially before the apparition of the cotyledon out of the soil. So what we can do after such a denoising could be, so if I take maybe apply again the mean shift here is simply so to have let's say 8-bit color conversions, maybe not the best choice. It would be better maybe to have a first, let me do it again, green shift here, yes, and I will have maybe a HSB conversion, and I will maybe keep up with one of the channel which is highly contrasted for us on this one. And then very easy to segment the correct color corresponding to the the color corresponding to the leaves. So by just selecting a threshold, adjust threshold, then I can have a kind of a binary image. So let me do this stack. I have an hyper stack. We'll stack to stack. And then basically thresholding will do the job. Another option can be to use machine learning. I can take again my single image here and to go to in plugin segmentation and to select the trainable Weka segmentation. So here, my task is simply to indicate what is soil, what is leaves, and to ask the machine to train on this classifier. So I just give the machine some example of what I called a leaf and what I call soil, and the machine will learn how to take decision, so how to fix the threshold instead of me having to build a threshold based on the colors or on the shape, the local shape of the leaf. So it's much longer to compute in this case, but now it will be almost finished for this. So we see that the result is not perfect at all here, but I can again add some more features and look at the result after this update. So this is applied not only on this image, but actually also on the other images. I can decide to re-annotate maybe at some point. Sometimes it's interesting to add an additional. I missed. Maybe this one was not a good one. I misannotated it, so the result was very bad. I was put on the wrong class, so it just need to double click it on it again, and it will remove. Voilà. So here we are, and here again some. So everything of this is also accessible in Fiji. Well, the result is not perfect, but I would say not bad. So if I'm interested when I'm converging for this, just need to create the result. And now I have my segmentation, which is here. So here it should be a much more accurate version of the evolution of the surface of the leaf area index this is what I'm testing in. So for instance, if I converting it to 8-bit here, maybe I will invert the gray levels and again do a plot z-axis profile. Okay, I have a view of when some events are happening so basically everything is starting around here And this is where the cotyledons are opening. And, basically, I would be able to detect automatically such events individually on each pot. So here, if I'm happy with such a result, I only train on one pot. If you believe that all the pots are similar, what you can do is save your classifier here, and then reload your classifier and apply it to the rest of the image or to any other pot. Another important stuff can be that you can actually open this black box and have a look at what are the parameters that were used in here. So I encourage you, if you want to have a better understanding of what's happening in here, to read the tutorial and the help on how to use Weka and to understand all of the parameters that can be tuned. This can greatly reduce the computational time and also the efficiency of your model. There are actually alternatives to Weka, which is very slow, which is not, we use it in our group only for didactical purposes, so pedagogical purposes. And a nice alternative to similar approach is called Elastic, that we encourage you to have a look at. And there are some also tutorials on how to use Elastic on our YouTube channel. So basically, that's about it. Here, I've done everything by just clicking. And you may know that in Imagi, you have this possibility to write some codes, macros. So either it just records your click, you don't have to program anything, or you can also start your own macro. And you can select your language. So in the past, it was only limited to Imagi Macro, which is a specific language, maybe not very interesting because not a lot of people know out of university how to do this. But now it's possible to do it in other languages, which are more, let's say, data science friendly or bioscience friendly. So, for instance, you can script in Python or you can script in R, which are typically the kind of that bioimaging community likes to use. So, could automate and connect all the codes and calls of functions that I've been using in this demo. Via a macro specially dedicated to your own problem. So this is it for me, and let's see if you have questions.